went there and I brought my attorneys and my accountants with me. Looked at it, saw it. Within 2 hours, I said, you know, I'll do the deal. And my accountant said, don't do it. Went to the other room, I said, don't do it. My attorney said, don't do it. Too much FDA and all that stuff and all that stuff. Don't do it.
It makes more people famous.
Yeah. So I said, yeah. So I said, well, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it because it has sex appeal. Mm-hmm. By sex appeal, I mean everybody has a heart.
Yeah.
Everybody abuses it.
They can all relate to that, yeah.
Everybody abuses it. And there's no solution to the problem, yep, as he calls it. But this is a solution to a problem. Mm-hmm. Bingo, that's, yep, what I'm about.
Yeah.
So I said, okay, and I said, I'll do it. So I put $250,000 in it, okay?
For a 30% share.
30% share. We went and I handled all the business part of it. And within about maybe a 5 year period, it made us about a little over $600 million, which I had 30% of.
So they came in and bought it out?
Yeah, they came back after that. They wanted to change the royalty on it, you know, because...
The patent or something.
Yeah, and I said, no. I said, we're not going to change it. If you want it, just buy the patent from us. So that was another $150 million that they paid for the patent after that.
Nice.
So anyway, it was a good run, and it was good. But what made me feel good about it is that, and all the medical write-ups and stuff like, mm-hmm, this, it touted us as one of the 10 patents that changed the world.
Is this good distance here, you think?
Yeah, it's pretty good distance. Yeah.
All right.
It's pretty good.
What about this thing? Does this thing need to be anywhere in particular?
Be mad. See an opportunity by being an entrepreneur.
Okay.
Consider yourself an opportunist.
Yeah.
Nothing's going to work unless it's needed. And trade things that are different. It's going to be a bridge to nowhere.
Words of mass destruction. Words of mass destruction.
Welcome back to another episode of Words of Mass Disruption. This is the podcast that talks to entrepreneurs and business leaders about their stories of disruption. And we follow them on their journeys and learn from their stories and their experiences. As always, I'm your host, Eric Haynes. So welcome back from the first part of the Phil Romano story last week, the legendary restauranteur and entrepreneur, Phil Romano. We're going to have the second part of the conversation. So we got the early history all the way up to Fuddruckers, mid-80s. And this is a story about the finances and the investments and the investors, and the investors are backed out of Fuddruckers. How he took a $15,000 unit and turned that into a $3.4 million value. So this is how he built his empire. This is how he got there. We're talking about the deal he made with Johnson & Johnson, an investment in the heart stent and bringing that to the world and making a significant change in the world for sure. We'll talk about how he takes the same value system in his Bill of Rights. He'll talk about the five principles and the things you need to know that you can apply to your personal life as well as your business, and that have made him successful more than any other restauranteur out there. And that's for real. So please share this. Please take a little bit of time. Make sure you're following me or following the podcast. You don't have to follow me. That'd be weird. But we're on Spotify now. We're on Google. We're on all of the platforms. So if you can go follow on each one of those, that'd be amazing. If you could take some time today and think of two or three people that you can share this with through Instagram or Spotify or iTunes or whatever, and think about a couple people that would be inspired by this or could use or learn from it or whatever, you know, I would appreciate that. And then if you could rate 5 stars or a couple stars, I don't know, 5 stars would be good. And one more thing. So when we were recording this, we had a full-on video crew. So we're testing a concept that we're still working through now, where we do kind of like a 30-minute show version of this, like on TV quality, recorded 3 cameras, lighting, several sound guys. And we do kind of a walkthrough of the venue. We're at the network bar, we're recording right in the middle of it as customers are in there eating and talking and doing their business. And we are going to release that video at some time in the future, but several times I speak to the camera and I refer to that. So I didn't cut any of that out. I just thought I'd leave the whole conversation here because everything's pretty interesting. And there's some segments too that we didn't put in here because they didn't really make sense, where we're at the bar making drinks and we're walking through the venue talking about the value of it. But you got all of that through the conversation with me and Phil. So sit back, enjoy, let me know what you think about it. If you share it, I think that was a pretty positive response. So I appreciate if you did that. Now here's a conversation with Phil Romano.
Let's talk about the economics of Fuddruckers. So I really like this story. You know, for the people that are listening, they like to hear these things. Okay. When's the right time to invest, right? So you had to raise some money to kind of get it going to the next level. And you put out 10 shares of the company that made up 48% of the value of the company at $15,000.
Yeah, let me tell you the whole story, because you got to start from the beginning.
Yeah.
You know, I went out and I found this building, you know, where I could put my first one. Mm-hmm. Fix it up, I was going to lease the building, and it was going to cost me about $150,000 to do the first Fuddruckers. So what I did was I went to my bank. I made this banker famous because he said no. It was Charles Cooney. I was doing a lot of stuff with him. You know, since I got to San Antonio, I did all my stuff with him, and you know, it was successful, and he was happy. He's coming to my restaurants all the time. And I said, hey, Charles, I want to open up a restaurant. I told him what I wanted to do at Fuddruckers, call it Fuddruckers and do this and do that. He said, another hamburger place? I said, yeah, but different. Okay, a lot of big points of difference. I'm going to do it this way. It's never been done this way before. And, you know, it's going to be my bill of rights. Mm-hmm. And he says, I'm not going to do it. I'm going to be a Dutch uncle. I'm going to save you all these problems. I'm not going to do it for you. I said, well, hell, Charles, I'm going to do it anyway. So I went off and I had this little place, Enoch's. Mm-hmm. Okay, and that's where a lot of these businessmen were coming in there. So I made a nice presentation and I told him what I wanted to do. And I said, I wanted to raise $150,000. So I started my corporation. I said, I'm going to sell out, 48% of it for $15,000 a unit. 10 guys. 10 guys got them together, no problem. They liked the idea. They're going to take a shot with it. You know, back then, it was interesting because you could write off your R&D.
Yeah.
But they should do that again. Yeah. So people were willing to invest in new concepts and new things and new ideas. Mm-hmm. So anyway, they all put their $15,000 in. And some stayed in, some wanted to get out, so I bought them out for maybe $20,000, you know.
And making them famous too, by the way.
Yeah, made them famous by not staying in.
Not staying in for three more
but
years.
Yeah. As the story goes, within 2 years, okay, they never had to put another penny in it. Mm-hmm. But the corporate, no liabilities or anything else, you know. And we end up, that ended up being worth $3,400,000 a unit.
Yeah. The 15,000 turned into three. This is only 3 years later, right?
No, two years.
2 years.
2 years. 2.5 years later.
Yeah.
3,400,000.
Do you send a thank you note to the ones you bought out for 20,000?
Yeah, they. One of them had a nervous breakdown. Really, he did.
He invested in the next thing and stayed in.
Yeah,
right?
No. But it wasn't too hard to get people to invest in me after that.
Sure. Yeah. No kidding. So, out of all the concepts you've done all time, what is the concept that you're most proud of?
The concept I'm most proud of is my son. Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. Sam, right?
Sam, yeah.
Yep.
You know, I was 55 when I had my son. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm glad I was an older parent because I had a lot of wisdom to bestow on him.
Yep.
And I remember my job was to drive him to school every morning. Mm-hmm. You know, so I had to
get that one-on-one time with him.
Yeah, right. I had captive audience. I could brainwash him. You know, and make him believe and think the way he should be thinking.
Hey, by the way, there's a lot of people watching this right now. Wish they could get brainwashed by you on a regular basis.
So anyway,
so what'd you teach him? What'd you bestow upon him?
What I told him, you know, I said, Sam, there's five things you have to be and do to be a good person. Five things. Okay. Number one, you got to have principles. And principles are, we talk about that, and principles are doing what you said you're going to do, sticking to your deal. Mm-hmm. Number two, you got to have responsibility. You got
to
be
back to this bill of rights again with him.
Yes, right? Yes, same thing.
Okay, treating him like a business.
Right,
right.
Right. Okay. In fact, give him his value system, as you want to call it, exactly. Rather than principles, rather than the bill of rights. And the second one is responsibility. You got to be responsible for making the right choices I'm responsible for the consequences if you don't.
Yep.
Number three, you got to have integrity. You don't lie, you tell the truth, you be honest. You don't lie to yourself.
Too many people don't get that one.
That's right. And number and number four was you got to be able to communicate. You tell people how you feel, don't let them tell you how you should feel. Mm. You think for yourself, don't let them think for you.
Right.
And you express yourself, you communicate yourself. And the fifth one has three things in it. It has love of God, patriotism, and charity. Mm-hmm. Now, I trust you, you're my kid, mm-hmm. right? I'm going to give you a good, you know, but I don't trust other kids.
Yeah.
But if you have this value system, you're going to pick kids that have the same value system.
Yeah,
you want to pick a friend. You don't want to pick a friend that lies to you, that says he's doing one thing, does another.
That's true.
So what you got to do is you take them and say,
if you're not going to influence them, someone else is.
Yeah, and they're going to pick you as a friend.
Right.
Okay, because
don't
you're.
Don't want me. No, not me.
Well, I mean, somebody with that value system.
There you go.
So that's, you know, what I've, and he stayed with him. And today we still talk about it. Still points it out. He still has all those things. And I took it a step further with him. Every company you build, or concept you build, it has to have a direction, right? Mm-hmm. It has a strategy. Mm-hmm. So I said, okay, Sam, here's your strategy for life. I gave him an organizational chart. On the very top of it, I put your health. Without your health, you can't have anything. Mm-hmm. It goes down, it goes way over to the left, and it says, parents. And what are the parents supposed to provide for you? That's all the things that you got to get from your parents. You know, you got to learn how to become independent. You got to learn, you got to get a value system, right from wrong. You got to learn love, the affection, all that stuff. The parents got to teach you that. Teach you to be independent. Take care of yourself. The next one is academia. What's that going to do for you? Well, it's going to teach you ABCs. It's going to teach you about life. It's going to teach you the facts of life. It's going to teach you the laws. It's going to teach you all these different things you got to do and obey and go on in life. And it's going to teach you to get in the college. It's going to teach you probably going to be your job someday, your career and all that.
Whatever.
The next one is your girlfriend. Okay, your girlfriend is going to be, you're going to learn emotion, about love, companionship. You know, you're going to learn about the opposite sex. You're going to learn all this stuff about it. Okay, and it's going to be a lot of enjoyment on that. The next one is sports, athletics. And my son, I said that's important too.
Yeah, he's lacrosse player.
Lacrosse player at Syracuse.
Yep.
Okay, and I said, what's that going to do for you? It's going to get you in college. Mm-hmm. It's going to be prestige. Teach you teamwork. Teach you to be a winner. Work hard. You get something, you got to work hard to get it.
Yeah.
And then the fifth one, the last one over there is your friends. What do your friends do? Well, again, companionship, camaraderie, being with them and all that, going through life with them, okay, all the way through life with them.
It's almost like a mirror of your own value system.
That's going to get you out of college. That's going to get you into college and out of college. Yes. After that, these change. Your parents aren't, they did their job, you use them right, use them properly, you're independent, you don't need them anymore. They're there for you, but you don't need them. They're going to probably be needing you.
Yep. Yeah.
The next thing is your academia, that's your job, that's your career, that's what you become. Your girlfriend, that's going to be your family unit. Mm-hmm. Okay, and that's the one you're going to go through life with. And sports, it's going to keep you healthy. Whether it's running, jogging, tennis, whatever it's going to be, that's the fifth thing. And your friends, that's your world. Mm-hmm. That's who you're going to be hanging around with, doing business with, going to their funerals, going to their weddings, being there, watching their kids grow up together, growing kids together, doing all that. That's your life. Mm-hmm. And all these things are very important to you, but that's your direction, that's your life, you got your value system, got your life, now go get it. Mm-hmm. And you're a good kid, turned out great, but I brought him up like a business.
Soon, right? And he's graduating soon, right?
He's graduating in December, half a year early, yeah.
Good.
But he's a smart kid, good kid, got poise about him, he's got everything, I couldn't ask for a better kid. Mm-hmm. And
so you say you brought him up like a business?
I brought him up like a business. Yeah. Now, you think about it, that value system I gave him?
Yeah.
For a business to be good and successful, it has to have those, right?
Yes, yeah.
It has to have principles, it has to have responsibility, it has to have integrity, it has to be able to communicate, mm-hmm. its message and all that stuff, it's gotta be charitable, mm-hmm. it's gotta be patriotic, and it's gotta have a love of God.
So you got a system, that you work through with him, just like you do your successful businesses.
Yes, yes.
How does that translate to being married and your wife? Is there a system there as well?
Yeah, well, you know, everybody has systems for everything, I guess, you know. The guy tells me the story one time. He said, you know, he said, I've been happily married for 50 years. I said, so tell me about it. How'd you do that? He says, well, on our second anniversary, I took my wife to Hawaii. On my 49th anniversary, I went back and picked her up and brought her home. So it works.
You
got to have a system.
Exactly. That's perfect.
There was a question, my second most enjoyable concept that I've done is...
This is something they really don't know. A lot of people don't know this about you. When I say he saves lives.
Yeah.
Including
my own.
Yeah.
Well, you know, and that's why I like this so much. I like this concept. I made a difference again. Mm-hmm. Made a difference in the world. The world didn't have
got
this.
Got mad again.
Yeah. So what I did was, I remember it's a country club deal. Mm-hmm. I was president of the Dominion Country Club in San Antonio, and I was having dinner with this young cardiologist that was going through his fellowship at Fort Sam Houston. And he came in, he said, you know, I'm working with this radiologist at the University of San Antonio, UTSA. Mm-hmm. It's the University of Texas. And he said, he's invented this little stent that it keeps the vessels around the hearts open, to keep veins and vessels open. You know, clog up and keep them open, keep them from closing up again. And he said, it's working. We gather them baboons, we gather them dogs, you sacrifice them, look at them.
This is around 1986, and before this really existed.
This is about 1985, I guess.
Yeah. So mid-80s, so people
mid-80s,
that are watching this just accept this as reality today.
Yeah,
So this is how it started?
Yes, so wow. They came to me and they said, look, would you be... He was telling me about it, and I just got out of Fuddruckers, you know, so I had a lot of money to invest, and looking around at what I want to do, and, you know, and one of the hard things to do is start investing in other people's ideas.
Yeah.
Because I always had the best. I'll do it. I'll look at somebody else's
idea.
But
everybody turned him down, right?
Nobody wanted to do it. They went to the major companies, and that's why I keep saying I do dumb deals, mm-hmm. because I'm not a... Harvard MBA or anything like that. They got a model they got to go by. Mm-hmm. Well, I'll get out of that model. I'll go. I don't need a model. I like I said, that's funny. When I went to the hospital to see the whole project, they wanted to present it to me. I went there and I brought my attorneys and my accountants with me. Looked at it and saw within 2 hours, I said, you know, I'll do the deal. And my accountant said, don't do it. Went to the other room and I said, don't do it. My attorney said, don't do it. Too much FDA and all that stuff Don't do it.
It makes more people famous.
Yeah. So I said, yeah. So I said, well, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it because it has sex appeal. Mm-hmm. By sex appeal, I mean everybody has a heart.
Yeah.
Everybody abuses it.
They all relate to that, yeah.
Everybody abuses it, and there's no solution to the problem, as he calls it. But this is a solution to a problem. Mm-hmm. Bingo. That's what I'm about.
Yeah.
So I said, okay. And I said, I'll do it. So I put $250,000 in it, okay?
For a 30% share.
30% share. We went and I handled all the business part of it. The doctors handled all the
medical
stuff.
Do the stuff you
stuff.
Know. Let them do the things they know.
Yeah, right. I watched them so I understood it.
Right.
And then I did all the negotiating with the companies and that, all that stuff. And had my team that I put together that were good at what I couldn't do with it. But we got it. So we negotiated probably the highest royalty ever that Johnson & Johnson gave. We got a 10% royalty.
That's just at the beginning. That's not even...
Oh, no. They bought the whole thing from us. So anyway, the story be told, we did it, and they paid us $10 million cash up front, certain milestones. We did that within 6-7 months. And then
most people would be happy there. Maybe I turned a $250,000 investment in 10 minutes. They'd be happy right there. Yeah. We had to keep.
But the royalties started going. That's when I went to the market with it. And within about maybe a 5-year period, it made us about a little over $600 million, which I had 30% of.
So they came in and bought it out?
Yeah, they came back after that. They wanted to change the royalty on it, you know, because.
The patent or something.
Yeah, and I said, no. I said, we're not going to change it. If you want it, just buy it. Bought a patent from us, so that was another $150 million that they paid for the patent after that.
Nice.
So anyway, it was a good run, and it was good. But what made me feel good about it is that and all the medical write-ups and stuff like mm-hmm. this. It touted us as one of the 10 patents that changed the world.
Yeah, I agree. You know, do you see the irony though in selling hamburgers and then getting into the heart business?
Oh, I'm lateral integration. I make them disease and I fix the disease with the less of a scent.
But but it came back to you personally a few years later, right?
Yeah, you know, it's funny. No, it's not a few years, about 35 years later. Mm-hmm. I got a summer home up in New York in the Finger Lakes. I was born up there, you know, so mm-hmm. I like to go up there. And I was running up the hills. There's a lot of running and working out all the time. And I was running up the hills. And man, I got up there and it was hard to take a deep breath. And mm-hmm. like I had heartburn, so. Mm-hmm. Put two and two together, and I called my the cardiologist here in town here, Mark Jenkins. He's a Methodist here, and we became friends. He went to John Hopkins, you know, and mm-hmm. he's had the cath lab. He's very, very good. So I said, Mark, I think I need one of my stents. So I told him, he said, yeah. He called me in a prescription and get in my airplane and come on down there. So I was back here by 7 o'clock the next morning. By 1 o'clock, I had two stents in me. Okay, I had a problem in the veins that were called the Widowmaker. Wow. So I didn't get them fixed, that would have been, you know, curtain. But I never had a heart attack. I was in good shape, but I knew when I was feeling different, you know.
You went in quick.
Went in quick and got it squared away. That was 35 years after I did it.
Wow.
It's like eating my own food 35 years after.
Yeah, no kidding.
I saved my own life, you know, unbeknownst to me.
That's amazing.
And it worked out, but that was 8 years ago.
So you are known for downtown Dallas restaurants and through Dallas, you know, the Nick and Sam Steakhouse. You got the Eatzi's concepts around Dallas and in Texas. And there's this area across, you know, Trinity River. A lot of people talked about developing the Trinity River area, and you always hear these ideas and these stories, and no one ever did it. But now you've delivered. What you started a concept over here where we're at now on the other side of the river. What got you over to the side of the river, and why were you the first one to really go in and do it right?
Well, you know, I started out with a medical fund that my partner and myself have. It's called mm-hmm. SHD, Scientific Health Development. People keep wanting to invest in medical deals because they found out what I had done, and mm-hmm. We got three medical funds that we have, so we invest in different things. So we're looking at getting diversified a little bit more. I said, you know, we ought to start buying up real estate,
mm-hmm.
you know, and then buy probably homes that things are going bad at the time, buying mortgages up. And we said, we probably know half the people we're buying the mortgages from. I don't like that. That's blood money. So I said, I don't want to do that. And then I was reading about what was going to be happening here. And I said, you know, what we ought to do is go on the other side of the Trinity and start buying up property. I mean, that's got, you know, a view of the city.
Mm-hmm.
It's everything's got to be growing out that way.
Mm-hmm.
And if they put these bridges, if they put the bridges in, because you know, political shit,
right?
Don't know if it's going to happen.
For a long time too. Yeah.
So I said, let's go and start buying up some land. I told Stuart. So Stuart said, you know, I know somebody, Stuart Fitz, and
your partner.
Yeah, my partner. He said, well, let's go. He said, I know a guy over there that buying a lot of that. He owns some of that stuff in a partnership. His name is Butch McGregor, and his kids played. Ball with our kids at ESD. So I called Butch, and Butch was dealing with this old Lebanese guy over here. He's a partner, one third partner with him.
That was buying up the property up over here. Right?
Yeah, they're buying up property, but all residential, all houses. We said, well, you know, so we said, well, let's look at it. We looked at it, put a deal together. I think we're going to pay $10 million for it all. And had it all set ready to go. And the guy was very, you know, meaning, you know, going along with everything he wanted to do, the old guy. But finally, come to the last 11th hour, ready to close, he says, you guys are pretty smart, he says, and to buy this stuff. So I'm going to be smarter yet. I'm not going to sell it.
Mm-hmm.
So you want to sell it to us. And so Butch jumps up and says, well, buy me out. He says, okay, we'll buy out for the price we established. So he's trying to get the price down low enough to buy a Butch out.
Yeah.
So we had Butch. So we took Butch in to put the money in with us and come in here with us. So we got Butch, and Butch, instead of going to all this residential stuff, which is a big problem now, we said, let's just buy up Singleton and go commercial. We did commercial. We're saying, you know, we kept buying up land with 100 acres. And it's like a dog that chases a car. What the hell does he do with it when he gets it? And we started thinking about it. And all of a sudden, I started realizing that, that, you know, these new market out there, these millennials.
Yep.
They don't like anything we did. They want anything different. They don't like our restaurant. They don't like our what we left them. They want their own mark. You know, want to mark their own drummer, and they know everything. Can't tell them anything. They know everything. They like to discover things, help make them successful. You know, they eat. They don't dine. Stuff like this, you know. So we looked at it, and I said, you know, I got a whole Stuart and I were talking. I said, you know, I did this in San Antonio. I did Leon Springs, where I put Rudy's Country Store and Macaroni Grill and.
Yep.
And let's see, and what else was it? Mexican restaurant, Cozumel's.
Cozumel's, yeah.
But that back then was called Nacho Mamas.
Mm, Nacho Mamas, that's right, yeah.
So anyway, we end up thinking about this, and I'm gonna put a group of restaurants together here, you know. But and so we started thinking about that. We started going along down that track with it, you know. And we started saying, okay, you know, we think that we need to get these new concepts for the millennials. And who better than create new concepts, or I call them new people.
Yeah.
So we did like a Shark Tank. Mm. Get down here, we got the word out, you know, and we structured it. I mean, this is an incubator, okay? It's one of a kind right now. It's called an incubator. We want to incubate brands, young brands for by young people, for young people, for new people.
Right.
So we set the premise. We got this whole place over there was a trucking terminal. So we got it, divided up 3,500 square feet plus outside dining. It seats about 125 people. It's got to do at least $2 million in sales. We get them in we give them the box, you know. We listen, they got to have they can't put more than $500,000 in a finish out. It's got to be owner operated. Okay, so we started interviewing people about this stuff, and they'd get them, and they had to do a five pager business plan. We had to taste their food, or if it's a manager, we had to understand his back history, understand them, check them out pretty well, and all that stuff. And we would tell them, and there's no guarantees on the lease. Mm-hmm. Okay, so as soon as we said, okay, you'll give you a location here, okay? And the first thing he said, ooh, I'm a new guy, I don't have $500,000,
right.
Don't have any money. So we started an entrepreneurial fund.
Okay.
Okay. And that's all these, a lot of businessmen in town, the vendors that they're buying from, you know, and all that stuff, like starting their own pipeline. If they grow, they're going to be still doing business with them, their partner, they got to. And, you know, individuals, banks, funds, and all that stuff come in. So we got to think of a $14 million fund together. And we said, okay, we'll put up to $500,000 in your idea.
Wow.
Okay. If we do that, we'll own 50% of it. And we will be the general partner.
Yeah, they have no excuses now. They just got to go be successful.
And they just got to make this thing successful.
Yeah.
Now, what we'll do is we'll charge you a 6% rent of sales. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if it's not low sales, they don't have to worry about that much rent.
Yep.
It's high sales. It's okay. They're going to be making money.
Yep.
And I said, second, then we'll charge you a 5% management fee. Mm-hmm. This management fee will be, and it's a separate company we started. They're separate. And we got Bob Sambo runs that for us. But what we'll do is charge you a 5% management fee. Mm-hmm. Okay, and we'll do all the back of the house. That's 2.5% from you and 2.5% from us, because we own half of it. And we'll do all the back of the house for you. All the books, all the pay all your bills, taxes. We do a cumulative buy-in. Mm-hmm. You know, we get all that stuff going for you, get cheaper buys, because we buy all together with them and all that stuff. We pass all that stuff on.
So much
to them.
Better in a franchise. Yeah, for people that are trying to get in.
Yeah, the franchise, you know, so we're there.
Money forever for
we're there to help make them. Yeah, help make them successful, and we got the ability to make them, to grow them if they work.
Yeah,
we're creating new multiple concepts for around. But that size, it's the right kind of size to grow.
Has anyone copied this concept yet?
No,
I'm sure it'll happen.
That'll happen, but you know, it's like anything else. We got all kinds of people who wanted to do it in different cities and all that stuff, but we got enough to chew on over here. So we did this whole Trinity Groves now. We did it ass backwards. Besides, the funds got about 12 to 13% return, so they're doing good. Restaurants are doing, some of them that haven't done it now, we're starting to replace them, get new concepts coming in here. And we don't really look for new concepts. We look at new people with good ideas, chefs that are really coming up and good. Get them in here, say, okay, you want to own your own business? You want to be your own entrepreneur? You want to, you know, control your own destiny, want to own your own business? Here, we'll set you up, don't cost you nothing. Come in here, but create something new and something different. We test it out. If it is, we'll set him up. He's in business. Yeah. We go with it. So we're creating these new ideas and new food ideas.
So 40 years in the business, and he's still disrupting the business and doing things that no one else has done. So let's talk about my favorite concept over here, the network bar that we're sitting in here right now. Because a lot of these stories we've talked about and you shared with us, kind of it all culminates to where we're at today with a lot of those kind of crossroads.
Yeah, you know, when I created this, I had to do two things. I had to think from when I did and think about the future, too. I think of the past and the future. I put them together to come up with this. And it's funny. I took it off the old keyhole, right? And and I remember I was talking to my partner, Stuart, and I said, Stuart, this is what I want to do. It's like the old keyhole, put a private club here, you know. And he said, yeah, but he says, you know, people don't carry keys around with them anymore, but they do carry a telephone. Mm-hmm. So you got to open the door with an app and have an app to come in here.
And know? Everybody's watching this. You saw me earlier in the show come in with that app.
Yeah. So this is we said, okay, an app. So we got an app company. We got probably over $1 million invested in an app now, but that app is the key to what's happening here.
Right.
So we did that, and we started going out, and let's charge people to come in here. We made it nice, look nice like it does over here.
Yeah.
Very nice, very appetizing.
So you got that Nick and Sam's premium experience, including the service, look and feel. You got the exclusivity of a club, speakeasy. You're incorporating the millennial technology, right?
Yep. And and that's the way they think today.
Yeah.
I mean, if I did it any other way, they wouldn't gravitate to this.
Is that who you're targeting as members of this club?
No, we got three sets of members, and we target each one of them differently when we try to talk to them. Mm-hmm. We got the millennials. We charge, we're going to be going up at the price because we got sold over 1,000 members now.
You hear that price going up?
Yep.
Probably by the time you see this.
Over 1,000 members, you know, we got to start pushing it down a little bit so we start charging more.
Great value.
That's right. So what we're doing is we got, right now we're charging $500 for anybody 21 to 70. Or it's 21 to 30.
Yep, so.
Okay. From 30 to 70, we charge $1,000 a year. Mm-hmm. And then the 70-year-olds, we give them membership under maybe four conditions. One, okay, they've got to have been in business for themselves, a substantial business and successful. Two, they had to have worked for a major corporation, an officer in a major corporation, or be a professional. And then they have to buy a junior member for a junior member, for a young member.
Bringing people up.
Yes, and they got to volunteer to be a mentor.
Mm-hmm. Wisdom.
Yes, bringing this wisdom. And so anybody from 70 on down that needs advice, we'll try to pair them up with a guy that's done it in the same business. Come in here and talk to him. So he's talking to somebody that has done it. Meanwhile, this guy that he's talking to says, hey, this young person's got a good idea. You know, all he needs is money. Money comes in, we talk about getting a funding group for him. Mm-hmm. You know, put it together and stuff like this. We got groups now, you know, 21 and stuff like that, that wants to just look at first preference on some of these things. Good ideas come from young people now today.
Right. So it's up and it's down. It goes both directions.
It gives something for the old guys to do. They've been mentored and they want a mentor so they can be remembered.
Right.
And young guys go to them, they gravitate to them. But we're finding, this is what we're finding, that young guys don't want to go to old guys to get information because they're outdated. their knowledge of what's happening, they're out of the bandwidth. They don't understand it, and they don't know how to react to it, you know, the technology and all that stuff. So they're working amongst themselves. They're networking amongst themselves.
Yeah.
So what we do, we have fireside chats, and we have guys that are young guys that are successful, been in business, know what to do. Well, we get them down by the fireplace, and they have a fireside chat. Mm-hmm. So they listen to success stories.
Yeah.
How this guy be some success?
How to get started? How to hire the first five people?
Yeah. What I had to do? How hard I had to work? What I had to do? Legal problems I had doing? What you had to do to get around this stuff and all these regulations? All this stuff. They learn stories about success and how they got there. You know, it all boils down to just hard work, you know, and passion. You got to have passion.
So the way this is set up for the people who are watching, earlier you saw us do a fast forward kind of through the whole place. We need a walk through. So you got a lounge area, you got a bar, you have a dining area with the sous chef from Nick and Sam. So you got that quality food, and then you got a brand new menu too. And then we have meeting areas in the back that you can rope off, and you can
got blackboards right on.
Yep, blackboards. And we got the fireside area. So kind of the way I look at it, and I'm a member 5 months ago probably. And what attracted to me is, if you think of a Venn diagram, and there's like old money and people that have been there, done that, and then there's the people that are coming up like you're talking about, and then the people that are kind of in the middle that are maybe struggling or need help and stuff, and it kind of, this is where it kind of overlaps, and I don't know of another place that really brings these people together.
30% of them are millennials.
Yeah.
32% are women. That's across the board.
Number, yeah.
And then we got our average medium age in here is 42. Mm-hmm. Okay, and we got about maybe 10% 70s.
Yeah. So I got to tell you, I've only been a member here a few months. I've closed deals here that are significant. And I met an amazing group of people, extended my network. I appreciate it. So is there anything else you want to share about the network bar before we wrap up here?
Just the fact that it's working because of a need. Now, what do you, you know, when you make it successful, we're trying to make this thing successful, it could be make a model,
okay?
Make a model and give it a bill of rights and so forth with it. Then we got to grow it. And how would you grow something like this?
So you're going to scale this, put more locations out there.
Yes, and here's the thing, what we're thinking about doing, one of the ways it could be done is to license it. But you license it to a thing like Marriott Autograph Hotels, maybe.
Yeah.
A hotel chain.
A similar and lifestyle,
liable,
too.
And they're liable, they could put one in every city where they got a Marriott Autograph Hotel in there. Now that city and that club up there is networked with us. If somebody up there wants to come down here, they come down here, they got all these people available to them. They got all those people up there, all those members up there available to us and network with them. So you go in the city, you're not a stranger. You come in your network. So this could be all over the United States at some point.
So Phil, I really appreciate
okay,
your time.
Good,
that's great.
Good.
Thank you.
So I hope you enjoyed that conversation with Phil Romano. A lot of stuff for you to learn from that one, and go get your Bill of Rights figured out. So please subscribe, share, and tell everyone you know about this podcast. We've got lots of great content coming up soon. See you later.